First, I would like to thank this unique occasion to present a very long track two activity pursued at my institute since 2003, vis-à-vis Iran and intensified from last June. In my view, the crisis, today's crisis, in some way they are more difficult to overcome than the famous US-Soviet confrontation over Cuba. The reason for that are different, but essentially is the absence of any diplomatic channel. So the parties are in some way in a sort of trapped diplomatic and untrust. But war is not inevitable, even if it's very close. My personal point of view, because this presentation doesn't represent at all the point of view of my government, is that the time is running out, so there is no time to pursue a comprehensive technological fixing. And even if I am physics, theoretical nuclear physics, I don't believe that the solution is a technicality, but the solution might be in the political with some element of technicality. There are some positive spin-off recently, and in particular, the one is the concluded talk with Daia that Iran said it held constructive and positive talks. What I wanted to present is some idea concerning two phases, very short, with a different perspective, in some sense also with different agenda. The first phase is a sort of a key principle for negotiation. Of course, these are not new, I think many experts and scholars said, but the important is to, let's say, to go through many declarations from the Iranian side, in particular from the Supreme Guide, and to try to understand which are the key benchmarks, and I had done before this exercise. The second, I would like to suggest a preliminary nuclear action plan. Very preliminary, the purpose of this sort of a nuclear action plan is to create a mutual respect and confidence. And of course, the brilliant presentation of my friend, the previous speaker, should be the future. But again, I think that now we need to establish some key point in order to cool down the confrontation. The main purpose of my vision after so many years is that at the end the international community must create a path to allow to the Islamic Republic of Iran, to have a sustainable proliferation resistance and safe civilian nuclear energy. So what are my general principles? Again, I'm not discovering the wheel. I mean that first, do not attach precondition or limit the scope of the agenda. This has been many times the problem. The precondition must follow up from the negotiation. You cannot put as a priori. Second, it's easy to say it, and it's very difficult to implement. Avoid the language and action of humiliation and demonization. What I called to many Iranian friends, I called it so-called Mossadegh syndrome. My brother is a psychiatric, and perhaps I need also psychiatric therapy. And this is the key point. I mean, avoid to give the perception that there is a continuous and clandestine approach to humiliate, demonize the Islamic Republic of Iran. At the end, the negotiation process cannot be restricted to the nuclear issues. This is a really short time vision. The negotiation process must be, as Excellency said before, must focus on the nuclear because this is the priority. But at the end, the negotiation process must grant to all the regional Middle East actors economic development and security assurance. Of course, the third general principle is recognize that the nuclear talk must at the end provide a comprehensive solution of the nuclear conundrum. So, What are the three following general principles that I consider really mandatory? Since I am a European, I prefer to call the P5 as E3 plus 3 partner. So this is the main argument, and out of record, I discussed this also with the Iranian counterpart. Firstly, the E3 plus 3 must be a sort of a political forum, should set in this framework, in this political forum, should set in general the framework, the benchmarks, the goal for the negotiation. But the IAEA should have an enhanced centrality in the nuclear field. One, the general framework, the benchmarks, and the tasks are selected by the E3 plus 3, for my understanding of many past declarations by the Islamic Republic Iran, the IAEA must be the only interlocutor on technical detail. In other words, what I'm suggesting is that even if not formally, the file, the Iranian nuclear file, must be negotiated with the agency once the E3 plus 5 produced the framework for this technical negotiation. Second, as many speakers said, and again, this is very important, it's a mandatory confidence building and transparency. In other words, we need a paradigm shift in our approach. Is needed, if this paradigm shift is needed from the question of whether Iran can be allowed to enrich, to the question, this is the paradigm shift, how Iranian enrichment can be inspected, verified, and voluntarily constrained by Tehran in order to restore the full international confidence in the peaceful nature of its nuclear program. In other words, any negotiation must produce some light at the end of the tunnel, and not only, let's say, constraints. The time is going out. This is my personal point of view. The time that we have before to have a catastrophic military confrontation is in the horizon of a few months. So there is no time to realize a full comprehensive negotiation. What I'm suggesting is sort of two main stages. One short period of a negotiation, sometimes in the past they call it a pre-negotiation. By short period, that means a few months before spring. And this must be conducted, and this is the second element of my proposal, in non-public way. Forget mass media, forget everything. I mean, the progress must be done through the continuous inspection or visit of the IAEA inspectors to there, and all the communication must be channeled through the agency. Why that? It's obvious. Sometimes the disclosure of this evolution of some compromise destroy the environment for the obvious reason that each party has its own agency. So the two main pillars of my thinking in so short time is firstly to give to the IAEA the mandate, a clear mandate to find the technicality to solve this confrontation and to provide some sort of interim nuclear solution for the key problem, and the nuclear key problem. In meantime, the E3 plus 3 must develop some vision concerning how to address also the other dimension, not only the nuclear. And the second key element of my proposal is to try to do this in a discreet way and in non-public way. Of course, the last element of this general principle, and it has been quoted recently in the International Herald Tribune, but my center proposed this some years ago, is to have a repetition of Shanghai communication. So like the relational context created between Washington and Beijing during the Nixon and Premier Zhu Enlai. So what I'm saying here is that it's mandatory to start to think how to create a sort of a discrete dialogue between the US, trying to avoid that this approach is appearing the day after in the mass media. So these are the general principles. Again, I am physics, so I'm considering the Landau principle. The Landau principle say that when you have a complex phenomena, you need to try to start from a few elements and build up confidence and then to move to the other elements. So what I'm proposing is not a comprehensive nuclear action solution like the previous one. What I'm proposing is a sort of interim solution to cool down the tense relation. And it's based only on three elements. Again, few elements are better than 10, 25 elements, because remember that in any complex track one and track two negotiation, you need to find enough environment for creating in your domestic constituency the consensus. So the first is a voluntary confidence building measure. So I'm not proposing in this short time, that means a few months, to continue with the zero enrichment approach. Okay, this must be in some way the task, or in some way should be replaced, as we said today, by a different format of negotiation, by international consortium for enrichment. What I'm saying is that Tehran would signal to the agency, the International Atomic Energy Agency, and not to the mass media, that is slowing down production of uranium enrichment to create some sort of confidence. But on the other side, the E3+3 must start to think seriously how to negotiate a full supply agreement, fuel supply agreement, in order to meet its future energy, nuclear energy need. So this is not new. Again, here Tariq Rauf proposed some backup mechanism many years ago to ensure the supply of nuclear fuel. So let's to go immediately. Instead to try to create a complex mechanism of black box for centrifugal, some complicated swap, well, let's to establish some based on the market and granted by the agency and plus third party, some supply arrangement for the nuclear, the Tehran Research Reactor and the current and the future nuclear power plant. So, slow down the enrichment. The second point is the most serious concern for the international community due to, let's say, its potential military dimension. So what I'm proposing, again, in my minimalist approach, that Iran must agree to a proliferation-resistant technical solution concerning the production to date of about 80 kilos of uranium reached up to 20%. I mean, for people that are not physics, if you feed the centrifuge with already some high level of enrichment, then the time to go to the weapon level is less. Of course, in the past, the community, the international community, tried two approach. One is also based to remember here my colleague, like Russian colleague, it was the Russian proposal, so to send this, in this case, to send this 20% enrichment to third country with the technical capability or to reinvent a term of fuel swap. This should be a sort of a confidence building by Iran. Of course, you need to reciprocate from the E3+3. What I'm suggesting that the reciprocation must be done on a part of the refurbishing the Tehran Research Reactor, also with the two marginal measures that are not proliferation concern. provide a particle accelerator for the production of a radioisotope for nuclear medicine. This is some proposal that it has been done, it has been also suggested to the PRK. And also, just to attract the attention of the decision maker in Tehran, to solve the famous Eurodif problem concerning the return of 50 tons or the reimbursement of these 50 tons of uranium. So I think this can be created in a way which is a saving face for both the international community and the Islamic Republic of Iran. The last temporary interim item in this solution, in this nuclear package, is not confidence building, but in diplomacy, I should call voluntary transparency measures. And this is the most serious one. So Iran would allow visit to the workshop where centrifuges are manufactured, particularly the new models, and to agree in some way to establish some accounting mechanism like the one proposed this morning or implicit in this morning in the ABAC agreement. Why that? The aim of this transparency, voluntary transparency measure, would be to ensure the international community that the manufactured centrifuge are not transferred to non-declared facility. So very few elements. Of course, this last measure is outside of the comprehensive safeguard agreement and in some ways also outside of the additional protocol. Should be a sort of a transparency measure that Iran could consider in order to create this trust. I end now. My two main political recommendation is that we need to create a face-saving solution for all parties. We need in some way to involve more proactively not transatlantic countries, but I think I'm fully convinced and personally I'm studying a lot in this period about the security arrangement in the Persian Gulf. I think that the GCC countries are fundamental to be part of the solution rather than of the problem. And last one, to give once the E3+3 decide the minimal benchmarks and the framework to conduce the negotiation, give the negotiation to the International Atomic Energy Agency and ask in some way to check the progress if there are any progress in a discreet way. Don't go to the mass media. I mean, just through the IAEA International Agency channel. Thank you.